Greetings again. This is Pastor Ann Lutfi, and I'm so happy to be with you. I have another message, and it's even better than the other ones. So today, we're going to know and understand what God says. I've titled it, God Says. That's amazing. He says so many things to us that we should have a list, you know, from here to China or wherever on the earth with us, so that we can remember it. But the best way to keep in mind what the Lord says is to memorize scripture. I want to tell you, it works. At first, you get a little discouraged because Satan doesn't want you to know the word. He really does not want you to try to memorize the word of God. So he'll put an obstacle in the way, or he'll just make you goof up and put, one scripture in place of the other or whatever. He works that way. So what you do is just say, Lord, I want to learn your word, and I want to learn what God says. Yes, I do too. I have for all my life, but now I want to know it even more. So God says in Psalms 55, 22 and on, cast all your burdens on the Lord, and he absolutely will sustain you. What does sustain mean? Sustain means he'll take care of you. He'll provide for you. He will give you what you need. He will even put his arms around you when you need that. He'll give you a boost in your faith. He will give you protection wherever you go. He has his eye upon you. And there's a song that we all should remember. His eye is on the sparrow, but you and I know he's watching us, right? Yes, he takes care of all of his creation. From the tiniest little bug that we don't even know exists, a nanobug, you know, a mite, and to the highest, highest mountains. Everything God's created, he takes care of. He does not forget anything. We forget a lot because we're human. And if Adam and Eve would not have fallen in the garden into sin, we would still be as our Adam and Eve were before the fall. They had communion face to face with God. Can you imagine? The God of the universe had fellowship with Adam and Eve. Wouldn't that be amazing? One day very soon, we are going to have fellowship with this glorious, awesome God. I can't wait. I mean, I have to wait, but I can't wait because it's going to be so, so awesome. It's just going to be wonderful. So God says that you must cast all your cares on him because he cares for you forever. Caring for you forever means for all eternity. We don't know how long eternity is. We don't even know how to explain eternity except that it is countless. It's ageless. It is absolutely unstoppable. It is totally eternal. Do we know the meaning of eternal? Well, that's forever and ever and ever and ever. And for more ever and ever, ever, it's forever. Human beings, you and I, we can't comprehend, you know, eternity. But one thing we can understand is that God invites us to come to him so that we can be in the eternity of eternities with him as he judges in heaven. And then, of course, we are with God, caught up to the Lord in the air at the rapture. We will go into intensive training so that we can come back with him for the millennium. The millennium is the 1,000-year reign on earth. And we, you and I, will help to govern different places. I don't want to govern. I just want to be close to him. I just want to hear him more and know him more and see him. Because after the millennium is finished, then exactly at that particular time, Satan will be cast into the lake of fire along with the false prophet and all the other minions that have followed them all their life long. And God will cleanse the earth at that point in time. And we will rule and reign for him forever and ever and ever. Did you know that? Read Revelations. Just read it. The Bible says if you read the Revelations, just even one time, you'll get a big blessing. I want all the blessings I can get, Lord, so I'm going to read it again and again and again. Each time you read the Revelations or any other book of the Bible, you gain wisdom, you gain knowledge and understanding, and then you finally know at one point in time you couldn't understand that verse in Genesis or that verse in Romans, and now it clicks. And when it clicks, that's God telling you through the Holy Spirit, this is what it means, my child. Don't give up. Don't give up. Never give up. Never, never. Winston Churchill said that. We will never give up. We will never give up. Well, I'm not going to give up, and I hope and pray you won't either. Let's keep going. Boy, this is good. And then David said, but you, O God, shall bring down all our enemies to the pit of destruction. Now listen, not that I want anyone to go to the pit of destruction, but if God says it in here, in his holy word, it's evident. It's real. It's going to happen. All our enemies and all those that have come against us over all the years we lived on earth, and they wanted to torment us and bring us down, it's not going to work. God will bring them down, and they'll never rise again. They can't. Because in Proverbs, he also says, those that dig a pit for someone else to fall into will themselves be cast into that pit or that trap, and they will never rise again. And there are evil people that wish us harm, that wish you harm. They're jealous. They're hateful. They're vindictive. They're cruel. And they want something really horrible to happen to you. Well, you know what? Above all that, God knows, they will end up where they want to send you and me. That's the truth. That's right here. In the Bible. Always in the Bible. You must check it out, because the bloodthirsty and the deceitful men will not live out half their days. But I and you will trust in the Lord our God and our Savior. In Psalms 57, my soul trusts in you, O God. And in the shadow of your wings, I will make my refuge until the calamities have passed by, and my family also with me. I will cry to God Most High, who performs all things for me. I don't have to tell him, Lord, when we take a trip, can you please take care of the people that might be driving by with a gun or something and shooting? He's already taken care of them before you even leave your house, because he's already cleared the path. He's already set the angels of the Most High God on this side of the highway, this side of the highway, above, beneath, and all around, so that you will not be confronted with the evil that you've read about, heard about, or even seen in the news. Yes, because that's the kind of God we have. And he will not allow you or your foot to slip or be moved except towards him. Oh my goodness. When I read that, I said, Lord, there's been many a time that I thought I was going to fall, and yet somehow something happened and I didn't. You know what that was? That was an angel saying, uh-uh, you're not going to touch Ann. I got her. He grabbed me away, and I did not fall. Honestly, we had a friend that was coming from Dallas to have dinner with us because he was going to Europe. And so I made my dinner. We were all ready and waiting, and he said, I should be there. Well, how far is Dallas? He said, I'll be there in exactly 3 hours. And I said, don't rush. Please don't speed. Don't do anything like that. Well, he was speeding. And he did encounter a horrible accident. His car started fire. We didn't know this, but when he came, he told us. Anyway, his car had started to, you know, the gas had started to burn and be on fire. He was in the seatbelt. He couldn't undo it. He was so weak because he had hit his head in some way. And then he said he was sitting there and he said, well, I'm just going to die. I'm just going to die. And out of nowhere, he said, a hand came, a giant hand, grabbed him like this and broke the seatbelt, ripped him out of the car. The door was already on the floor. The door was not on the floor before, outside, on the ground, I mean, and set him like at least 250 feet away from the car on grass. That was cool. And then he saw the car just out of his unconsciousness almost. See explode. And then he had to get a taxi, and he wasn't hurt really bad, but he had to go to the hospital. So he called us from the hospital, and I said, oh my goodness, why are you telling me this now? You must not. And he said, I don't know, I had a heavy foot and something made me do it. And I said, well, don't ever do that again when you come into my house, but I'm going to pray that God will heal you. And God healed him. He had no scratch on him at all. He was in there a couple of days, and he was out again. And, of course, you know, the car was totally damaged, naturally, and there were some other things he had to take care of. But here's what the word says. I will counsel you and guide you with my eye up on you. I will lead you in the paths that I have prepared for you. So he prepared. God did not cause the accident. The other person did. And whatever men decide or women decide, you have a free moral will. And with that, either you do good and you can be careful, or you can be an idiot and a fool and cause accidents. So anyway, he was saved by the grace of God through that hand pulling him out. That was an angel. That was a powerful, powerful angel. And I like to tell that story to many people because we all have angels with us, because God tells us that we have angels surrounding us. They go before you, they go beside you, they'll go behind you, above you, beneath you, and all around, because these are agents sent to the household of faith. Real angels are agents sent to the household of faith. So if there are faithful people that truly believe in our precious God, they will have angels surrounding them. Now, there are people that are not, you know, faithful. They're just people that, they're the living dead. That's what I call them. They're the living dead. They have no God. They have nothing. They wander around and they can go from place to place. And God still has great mercy on them all because he loves humankind. He loves every person on the face of the earth. But he has a special heart of love for the believer because we are his by choice. You and I are his because we chose to be his. Never change your mind about belonging to him. He is so great and awesome and wonderful. My goodness. So in 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 3, the carnal nature of man does not understand or know or want to be in the presence of God. The carnal nature means the unregenerate nature. And so therefore, how can they possibly know what God says? They can't, because the things of the Bible, the scriptures, are spiritually discerned. Meaning, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you cannot understand what the Bible says. I mean, you'll read it and you'll read it and then you'll get disgusted and just say, well, this doesn't make any sense. Why would God even say that? Now listen, look at what he says here. This is so hard to understand, I don't even want to understand it. Oh, really? Well, then you're going to miss out. And then as David said, O Lord, you have delivered me. Your faithfulness endures to all generations. You have established the whole earth and it abides until you say no more earth. And the same thing with God's people. He establishes us through the word because this is a living word. Living, living, living. How can I explain that a little bit better? Okay, well, let's take a seed. We put a seed in the ground. Let's say it's a beautiful flower. And within a few weeks, there's a little greenery. Here's a little greenery. Pretty soon you go out there and it's this beautiful plant. Oh, it is just magnificent. Azaleas, for instance. And all the other flowering shrubs and trees and everything, God makes them for us. You know, he created all his beauty for you and for me so that we could enjoy it. There are a lot of people today that are not enjoying anything that God has created. Why? Because you don't know the Lord of glory. You've got to get to know him, please, you all. And he will reveal himself to you in power and in might, in wisdom and understanding, in the beauty and the splendor of his great creation. I cannot get enough of his beauty. When I see mountains, when I see streams, when I see forests and rivers, oh my goodness, or even the precious critters that he created, critters, that's a new word, critters, okay, critters, you know, because he takes care of all of them. Where in the world would an elk get a drink of water? Would he have to run down to the store and get a six-pack of water? Where would a deer or a bear get the food that they need? They're not going to go to, you know, Starbucks and say, listen, I want one of your sandwiches. God provides. God provides everything that his creation needs. Everything. If his creation needs water, he sends rain. If it needs a little dry spell, that's fine. He'll send out the sun. Some of us get more sunshine than others, like Texas, for instance, which is good because, you know, even that is something wonderful to thank God for, because I wouldn't want to be where it's really, really so many degrees below, because you have to have quite some stamina to live in cold places like that. But either way, God is the creator, sustainer, preserver, and protector of the whole universe. No one and nothing can ever outdo that. And by the way, there's no... greening of the planet. The planet will be green as God allows it to be green. Winter, summer, spring, and fall, superbly done, magnificently created by the Creator, and that will never change. Even though we have people today that are trying to brainwash children and kids in school, that there is going to come a change, and this is not, you know what, forget it. Go to the scriptures. He tells us in Ecclesiastes, winter, summer, spring, and fall shall never change. One season will follow the next season because God said it. God ordained it. God made it so. And when God makes it so, he also says so. I have created all things for my glory and your blessing. That's what he says. He is the great creator, sustainer, and he will never, never change. He will not abdicate. No, he won't, ever. People will, because people are fools sometimes. And if they try to take the place of God, it does not work. He is the Most High of all. And God says, if I am for you, my child, no one can be against you. Because if God is for you, no one can be against you. How does that work? Well, oh my goodness, this is so good. It's just too good. When God is living in your heart and you are filling your heart with the scriptures and you're praying and you love being in his presence, you're going to be a shining bright light wherever you go. I've had people, when I've gone somewhere and I wanted to reach for the door and someone runs up and opens it for me and I go, well, thank you, you're so kind. And they'll say, yes, ma'am. And I'm going, ooh, nah, they almost bowed. I don't want anyone to bow. But you know, God will just give you such favor that the favor of God is the best and the most beautiful gift that you can have. And when you love him, you have that. And he does not add any pain or worry with it. Whatever blessings he gives us, they are magnificent. And they will not cease or stop because he is the one that fills all of our paths with goodness. And every path drips with his goodness wherever we go. And when you go, as you do each day about your business or your job or your work or your home, he allows you to always, always shine brightly for him so that people that follow you or are close to you will be blessed in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in you. They'll want to be close to you and you don't even know why they're there. Well, I do now. I didn't years ago. I thought, well, what did I do wrong? Why are they so close to me? My goodness, no. That's because God has showered his favor upon you and you are his child and they recognize that. I've had people come up to me and today was such a beautiful thing. I have to tell you. We came and we went downstairs with a friend and we had a little drink, you know, and we were about ready to leave to come over here and film this and this lady came running and I thought, oh my gosh, I must have dropped something or I look weird or and she goes, ma'am, are you a prayer warrior? And I said, yes, I am. And she said, please pray that these children, she said, I think it's just one, but please pray that this will be twins. And I said, of course I will. And so I laid my hands on her belly and the other one on her arm. And I prayed a prayer of faith for this woman I did not know from anyone. And her husband, Bishop, I won't say it right now, was standing by. And as I was praying, he was saying, amen, amen, meaning agreement, okay? And then she said, oh, I'm so grateful. Will you be my mentor? I said, sure, I will. I'll be your prayer partner. So I gave her my card, and we hugged. And I said, you better call me. I've had people tell me they're going to call me, and they never do. But she said, no, I'll call you. I'll call you. I knew you were a prayer warrior. I just knew it. There was a light about you. And I said, oh, really? Thank you. And I left it at that. Don't ever make it bigger than what it is because that's not good because some people get a big head and they want to be more than what they are and that does not work with God. When God wants to lift you up and bless you to a higher plane with him, you don't talk about it. Just let God do what God does and you'll be blessed. So she and her husband followed me out of the little place where we had our drink. And she said, I can't wait. I can't wait, Pastor Ann. I just love you. And I said, honey, I love you too. I love you more. And then finally I said, by the way, what's your name? And anyway, she gave me her name and her husband's name, so they are on my prayer list. I don't have to know where you're from. I don't have to know where you're going. All I know is you want to be on my prayer list? Hallelujah, glory be. I will pray for you and all your needs. Then I have another young man that calls me. I've never seen him before in person. He is a relative of a lady that I know at our bank. She asked if he could call me because he was going through a divorce and he's hurting and he's just not himself. She was afraid he would harm himself. And so I said, yes, I will pray for him. Tell him to call me. So he has called me four times. The first time that I talked to him, he was so sad. I cried with him. And he said, I just love her. I don't want her to leave me or anything like that. And I said, listen, I want to give you three scriptures. You pray them every day. God is with you. He will comfort and counsel you with his eye upon you, and he will give you the victory. He will give you peace, and he will restore your joy. the joy of your salvation. And you need to let her go. If God is removing this lady, but she's trying to remove herself first, let her go. Have peace with God. And he said, oh, I'm so scared. I said, don't be scared. God tells you that you don't have to be fearful. The Bible has for God's promise, fear not, fear not, fear not, 365 times, one for every day. Now, why would he allow you to fear? But you've got to know what's in there. If you don't know what's in there, then you're missing out. Then you'll be fearful. Then you'll be scared out of your wits, and you'll make stupid decisions. So Travis, when I finished praying the first time, I just prayed for him most of the day. Then he called me 2 weeks later. We prayed again. He called me this last Friday, and he said, Ann, Pastor Ann? I said, yes, who is this? And he said, this is Travis. And I said, oh my goodness, you sound so good. He said, ma'am, I took your advice, and I prayed that scripture, those scriptures, every day, like you said, in the morning and at night. And if I got scared at night, I would go in the bathroom and read them again. I said, glory to God. He's healing you. He's restoring you. He's helping you. And then he said, I believe God really wants me not to beg this lady to stay with me, because she went to San Antonio with four of her friends, and they went to bars. And I said, no, honey, God is telling you, leave her alone. I can't tell you what to do, but I'm going to tell you this. This is a sign that God is saying, leave her alone, and God will deal with her. But you stand firm in the faith and strengthen yourself and be the man of God and become the man of God that God says you should be. Because you see, God says something about all of us in this beautiful Bible. This holy word has your whole life in it, and it has my whole life in it. Why? Because every single thing that you and I need for life and living and godliness is in here. Then he does not want you to miss out. And if you don't know it, then you're going to miss out. And then you're going to say, well, God, why did you prosper them and not me? Why did you give help here and not me? And then that's exactly the time that you need to also know that he is never going to take your disappointments and not work with them. He's going to take every single one of them, and he's going to prosper you and bless you, because that's his nature. He loves his children. He loves his creation. He loves the whole world because he created it. But men have polluted it, and it's become very, very ugly. So we don't want to do that. We want to hear the Lord. Wherever we are, God's protection is with us, and he hides us in the shadow of the Almighty. And we will live in his presence, and we will prosper in his presence, and he will speak of us all the good things that only he can. Man sometimes tries, but when he has a place for you, a promise and a provision, it will manifest. It will not fade away. It will not stop, because God said it. And when God says it, oh, my friend, I'll tell you what, it's going to happen. It's going to be glorious. It's going to be wonderful. It's going to be supernatural. You are becoming a supernatural representation of Jesus Christ. Isn't that amazing? It is. It is. It is so great. It is just amazing. The amazing God of heaven and earth will come to you anytime that you have problems. And then in times of trouble, he said, I will put my arms around you like a mom cradles her little baby. That's what he's going to do, because you are his. And no one and nothing can snatch you out of his hands. No way, no how. He is our great, soon returning God and King. And he loves you with an everlasting love, or else he would never have called you. He loves you with an ever, ever, everlasting love. And I am so deeply grateful that we were together again today. And one day I hope I can have a big coliseum here in Houston, and you can let me speak all day. I'm able to do that because God has given me that kind of strength. I cannot shut my mouth about the glory of God. I can't be quiet about how good he is. And I definitely want to encourage all of us and you out there that I love and just pray for all the time in a big and mighty way. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in the finished work of Calvary's cross. In Jesus' name and to his holy glory alone, that's my prayer for you. And if you would like to support our ministry, go to the Facebook, Pastor Ann Lutfi, and let me hear from you. I'm so delighted that you are there and I am here, and we're in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Bless you. Amen.